Most of the major rivers in the world have been shaped by centuries of human activity. River management intensified in the 1900s as people began to think of rivers as agents of economic and social opportunity. River after river was transformed to meet the ever-increasing demand for water, for industry, agriculture, recreation, electricity, tourism, and flood protection. Time and again, we learned that people can't out-engineer the rivers. Flooding occurs naturally. Development is what makes it a problem.
Rivers and streams left to their own devices want to meander. You know, we've gone in from an engineering standpoint. We've deepened and straightened a lot of our streams in Iowa, and now we see that there are bank stability problems. As we started to change some of the hydrology through our land use changes, through the channel straightening, we took what was a stable stream, made it unstable, increased some of the transport capacity of sediment down that stream, and so now many of them are in the process of trying to come back into an equilibrium with the new type of system that we have here.
Human engineering wasn't limited to rivers. The demands of urban centers and agricultural production pushed society to fundamentally change the landscape, leaving few natural settings undisturbed. At the heart of human management is the desire to conform and tame what was by nature wild and unknown.
They call them meandering streams. And there's a reason for that. It don't want to go straight down the line. It wants to wander around a little bit. But we and our practices try to straighten it out as much as we can. And that's probably wrong. The river's totally different than it was when I was a kid. If it's just weather patterns, part of it is changes in farming practice. We don't leave much grass grow out there anymore. It's all corn, beans. Very little livestock. Grasses and haylands filter the water and slow it down. It doesn't get to the river quite as fast. We put a lot of tile in the ground. We've built a lot of Walmart parking lots, and that water all has to go somewhere. None of that seeps into the ground. So just society, changes in society have changed the process of water moving down the channels. I think greediness is probably our biggest problem, but you can find that in all facets of life.
Although rivers are only 0.2% of all the fresh water on Earth, they are vital carriers of water and nutrients. Rivers drain nearly 75% of the Earth's land surface. They provide habitat, nourishment, and transportation to countless organisms, not just humans.
In the dictionary and in the textbook, they define natural resources as materials found in or on the earth that are used by man, and I said, or used by humans. And I told the students, and I tell the students every year, that I think we need to expand that picture to having resources being used by other living things. Because focusing only on what is valuable to humans, I believe has led to some of the environmental problems we have today. Too narrow of a focus. First we start thinking in terms of what's used by humans, and before long it's what's used by me. And then you narrow your focus so much that you start doing things to the resources that really impact other people's use of those same resources and other living things' use of those same resources. And I believe personally and as a teacher that if we focused on the things that are on our earth to be used are to be used by all living things, we would take better care of them and it would be better for all of us in the end.
It's all connected. Water that enters a stream in one location will be used by someone or something as drinking water downstream. Rivers are the arteries in a complex system that sustains life for a multitude of organisms. Bacteria, algae, plants, and animals all contribute to the biodiversity of our river systems.
There's a lot of ways to explain biodiversity. One that makes sense to a lot of people is that there's a lot of species we use in various ways, food sources, medicine sources, all kinds of things. And there's a lot of species that we haven't tested yet to see if they would be useful to us. If we drive them to extinction before we figure out whether they're useful, we're going to have missed that opportunity. Another way to think about it is biological species live together in a community, and they basically all have some roles in that community. We as biological scientists might have some ideas about some of their roles, but we don't necessarily understand all their roles. It's kind of like saying, okay, here's this puzzle. I'm not sure what this piece does, so I'm just going to throw it away. What do you have now? You got a puzzle that's not going to, you can't complete. So in a sense, all the species in a particular community, like in this stream that we're in right now, work together like parts of a puzzle. You start throwing away parts, who knows whether you're going to be able to put the puzzle together in a way that, you know, makes some sense.